Thanks very much for inviting me. I'm delighted to be here and to talk about Geddes, which was a passion of mine for some time, and still is. In 1995, I was on a study trip to Mexico, looking at the environmental impact of the NAFTA free trade agreement on the people there. And I was introduced to a guide who, on hearing that I was from Edinburgh, immediately interrogated me about Patrick Geddes, saying, how is he remembered? Is the university named after him? What way is he recognized? And after a while, he recognized that my completely blank expression meant that I knew nothing at all about Patrick Geddes, despite being raised in Edinburgh. So to my eternal shame, or maybe that of our education system, I had to confess to him that I'd never heard of him. He was astonished, and I was embarrassed. How could it be that this man knew more about such a significant figure, and I knew nothing at all? What did that say about my own culture and my own city? And what else did I not know? On returning from America, where I was studying, I sought to find out more about Geddes and immediately was struck by the connections between what I had been studying and his world of ideas. The connections between William James, Lewis Mumford, Thoreau, Bergson, the ideas of decentralized and participatory democracy, the ideas of ecology and education, the radical European strands of preschool education brought to Edinburgh by Geddes and the Edinburgh Social Union, that helped to create a progressive kindergarten movement decades ahead of elsewhere, with ideas of Froebel, Montessori and others being built in the rubble of the old town. This research opened up the notion of generalism and the generalist tradition, and through this the writing of Chomsky via Kelman and to George Debye on the democratic intellect. And above all, the ideas of cultural renaissance and expression, the idea of organicism and the radical tradition through Kropotkin and Alicia Reclus to Colin Ward and Murray Bookchin, opened out a rich vein of theory and practice that has barely been explored in our country. Today I want to draw on that vein and explore with you what it might mean. I'm going to be looking at cultural reclamation, mislaid culture and history, concepts of participation, continuities of cultural insurgency, and the rise of the Fifth Estate. So in the intervening period between my embarrassment in Mexico, we've gone from obscurity to ubiquity with Geddes. In the intervening 20 years or so since my embarrassment, Geddes has had a comprehensive resurrection. From relative obscurity, there's been a revival. There's a new version of the Evergreen, a collection of essays by Lewis Press, seminars, exhibitions, conferences, and happenings. Geddes has a statue by the Storytelling Centre. He's remembered in the foyer of the new Edinburgh City Council. His words adorn the Scottish Poetry Library. The Scottish Eco Schools curriculum is designed by heart, hand and head, and work is well underway to create the Patrick Geddes Centre at Riddles Court in a hugely ambitious project led by the Scottish Historic Buildings Trust. Their vision is to provide from within a unique example of an important 16th century building in the heart of Edinburgh's historic old town, a 21st century hub for learning, broadly based on the principles of Patrick Geddes, a pioneering town planner with a deep concern for the environment, education and conservation. This project, we're told, will adapt and repair Riddles Court, an A-listed building in the heart of Edinburgh's World Heritage Site with outstanding historic and architectural values spanning 400 years of Scottish history. It'll improve public access to the building and bring it back into use as a centre for learning based on Patrick Geddes' ideas. Riddles Court, rich and fascinating architecture and history, is the perfect place to spark the sense of wonderment that Geddes identified as the necessary first step in all genuine learning. This project has been developed and will be delivered by the Scottish Historic Buildings Trust. So we've gone on an amazing journey from 20 years ago, where somebody who was fairly well educated and brought up in Edinburgh and had been to the Equator, to the Camera Obscura, but knew nothing at all, to the point where all of these developments are happening. In fact, I was accused of mansplaining by my girlfriend when I was telling her about Patrick Geddes. She said, of course I know who Patrick Geddes is, everybody does. So it's interesting to think of what a journey we've been in that period and what that means. And that is the subtext to my talk tonight. All of this is very positive, but there is a tendency, I think, for his work to be diluted and sanitized somehow in this process. This isn't about prettified buildings and zoos and quaint but outdated educational theories. I don't mean to suggest that the educational theories are outdated, I actually think they're essential. But somehow, in that process, things get reduced to the most common denominator and the most presentable form of Geddes' ideas, and I want to reject that. So, some fantastic stuff. This is a terrible image, but it's an important image. Possibly a photograph taken by Geddes that shows a group of French anarchists at the Outlook Tower who were exiled from France after the Paris Commune. Paul Reclus, under the pseudonym of Georges Guyot, became Geddes' right-hand man in running the Outlook Tower, and Elise Reclus came to Edinburgh at least twice, in 1893 and 1895 as part of the summer school programmes. He wrote to his wife in August 1895, "In a few minutes I'm going to give my second lecture. The first went very well before a sympathetic audience who really seemed to understand French. My fourth will have to be in English and will be for an audience mostly of anarchist workmen. This will be the difficult part of the campaign." So in amongst the Geddes literature and the poetry and the tea towels, this story has largely fallen by the wayside. And I think that that needs to be rectified. Elise Reclus is an incredible figure. This is a frontispiece to his Homme la Terre, which shows the twin pillars of geography and history on either side. An incredible image, given the date, that's 1903. If you think about how the ecology movement captured and celebrated the iconic image looking back to Earth from early on, this is an extraordinary image. And Elise Reclus was a geographer of huge renown and an anarchist, and became a key collaborator of Geddes. Another prominent anarchist, the journalist Augustin Hamon, who lived from 1862 to 1945, was the editor of Humanité Nouvelle and was sought by the police for his anti-militarist writings. So if we were to trace a history of radical publishing and thinking, we must not lose sight of these roots amongst the sometimes soporific language of planning and architecture, or the sometimes dreary world of conservation. Much of this is identified and catalogued in Frank Novak's study of the relationship between Lewis Mumford and Geddes, published a few years ago, which is most of the letters between them. As Novak himself acknowledges, both Geddes and Mumford have expectations above and beyond mere policy and planning, and are stretching towards a concept of a rounded self, a citizen, which anarchists can draw inspiration from. Lest this be considered an artificial construction, there's a further element which demands a mention, connecting, as it appears to do, the ideas of Geddes with the organicist Murray Bookchin. Mumford writes, "Geddes made an important contribution in restoring the Aristotelian concept of potentiality and purpose as necessary categories in the interpretation of life processes." Novak explains that for Geddes, such potentiality and purpose are represented in man's capacity for insurgence, to which Mumford adds, "Man, for him, Geddes, was not just an adaptive organism, but increasingly the shaper and moulder of his own world." Keith Wheeler has suggested that it can be argued then it's possible to trace a line of descent from the morphological thinking of Goethe through Humboldt, Reclus and Haeckel to Geddes, which represents an alternative tradition in Western European thought, deriving inspiration from the paradigm of geography and ecology. This may well be true, but it now seems clear that Geddes should be seen as part of three further traditions: the utopian tradition from Charles Fourier to Ernst Bloch, to the Scottish tradition of generalism, and the organicist tradition from Aristotle to Hans Jonas and Murray Bookchin. Novak's book touches on these emerging debates. In doing so, he lays an important foundation for the arguments over the history of eco-anarchism, social ecology, and highlights Geddes as more than a piece of mislaid history. This is one of Reclus' globe concepts. At this time, we had an extraordinary convergence of anarchist thinking, geography, and mapping, and this involved the cartographers, the Bartholomews in Edinburgh, who were interested in how you map place and the relationship between mapping and globe. My point, I think, is twofold. In the effort to revive Geddes, we have sometimes slipped into an uncritical approach that, perhaps with good intention to present him in his best, have lost some of the edge of Geddes' thinking. We need to look at Geddes' publishing, not just in print, but in art, pamphlets, stained glass, and mural making, as part of a much more radical milieu. These were exiles from the Paris Commune, living with Geddes under false names to avoid police detection. So there is need for a second phase of Geddes' revival that reclaims him from his own revival. What we need is a history of Scottish anarchism. Second, we need to reflect on the journey we've come in the past 20 years and to celebrate the fact that uncovering Geddes is part of a far wider political awakening. That is, in my opinion, only at the beginning. So mislaid culture or mislaid history is a term that I've stolen from Professor Murdo MacDonald, who some of you will know who works here. And the idea is that our culture or history is mislaid not through some kind of conspiracy or foul means. It's just deemed unimportant and slips away. And that, I think, was very nearly the case with Geddes. And if his cultural output as instigator, collaborator, and motivator has at least had some recognition now, we can see a parallel with the likes of Phoebe Traquair, who came perilously close to falling into permanent obscurity. Geddes and Traquair have been salvaged, but many have been the subject of what MacDonald has called mislaid history. This cultural restoration has and had an explicitly political form. Writing in the International Journal of Scottish Literature in 2011, Julian Hannah writes, Outlook Tower acted as a symbol of resistance and a challenge to London's hegemony as a centre of innovation and cultural production. The connection between Tower and cultural insurgency should not be overlooked, as the French writer Pierre Chabard explains. The word outlook employed by Geddes to rename the Tower deserves attention, for its multifarious meanings reflect the numerous concurrent and sometimes contradictory strands contained in this project. Above all, it provides literal evidence of the fundamental importance of vision in the organisation and orchestration of the Tower. With his training in the natural sciences, biology and botany, Geddes considered first-hand observation of phenomena to be the basis of knowledge, being an interface between seeing and learning, between thought and experience. Observation was to him at once a tool and a method, a means and an end. Geddes therefore considered the eye to be an organ of fundamental importance to the intelligence, for it provided the means to decipher and understand the world. Having nearly gone blind when on a study tour of Mexico in 1879, Geddes always nurtured a predilection for the visual, painting, photography, optical instruments, diagrams, and other forms of graphic representation. What Murdo MacDonald has called a tradition of visual thinking emerges from this. Chabard also points out, it's interesting to note from the Reclus brother description that even though the principal function of the Tower was optical and panoramic in 1896, it was not yet called Outlook Tower. This appellation could not seem to have appeared until the very end of the 1890s, very probably in conjunction with the summer meeting organised by Geddes in 1899. So we begin to see here an interaction between the radical French tradition, the cartographers, the people that were creating globes and thinking about mapping like this, and this concept of outlook. So it's important to recognise that concepts of participation are absolutely crucial to this project and this time. The commitment to participation, decentralisation, community development and regional forms are everywhere in Geddes' work. He wrote in What to Do, which is an appendix to Paddy Kitchen's biography. Our faith is in moral renewal, next in re-education and therefore reconstruction. For fulfilment, there must be a resorption of government into the body of the community, How? By cultivating the habit of direct action instead of waiting upon representative agencies, hence these social imperatives. And he then lists 10 social imperatives, of which one is, let cities, towns, villages, groups, associations work out their own regional salvation. For that they must have freedom, ideas, vision to plan, and means to carry out. A, betterments of environment, such as housing fit for family and land for renewed peasantry. B, enlargements of mental horizon. C, community festivals and other enrichments of life. All these must be parts of one ever-growing design for the coming years to realise. He goes on, in general aim at making individuals more socialised and communities more individualised. To that end, let schools subordinate books to outdoor observation and handicrafts. Let teachers draw the matter and the method of education from the life and tradition of their pupils' own region, as well as from the history and culture of mankind at large. Let universities seek first for synthesis in the civic life around them, and only thereafter in the pages of philosophy. And he concludes, along all these lines there is movement, but lacking in volume and unity. A crusade of direct action has long been afoot, but with many halts and in sparse and isolated companies. The spirit creative is liberated and in flight, but too timidly and on disturbed quests. It is time for clearer understanding, closer cooperation, deeper unison between all men and women of goodwill and high endeavour. To engage the militant energies of the race in these adventures of constructive peace and heroically to salve the perennial wreckages of humanity would be the moral equivalent of war. So we begin to see from these statements an explicitly political element to Geddes' work, and it's not difficult to see the influence of the French radicals being sheltered in the outlook term. So I wanted to say something about continuities of cultural insurgency between our time and the 1880s, 1890s when Geddes was working. The Scots Renaissance is essay at the end of the first issue, Spring 1895, of Evergreen, begins on an elegiac note by commemorating the death of John Stuart Blackie, professor at Edinburgh University. Geddes writes, coming down the mound in full mid-amphitheatre of Edinburgh, filled as perhaps never before with hushed assemblage of city and nation, the pipes suddenly changed their song, ceased their lament, and Scots Wehey rang out in strenuous blast. The anthem of a renaissant, ever renaissant, unconquerably renaissant people. A country that doesn't elect its own government, defend its own borders, or function as a democracy is in need of perpetual renewal and renaissance. It needs constantly to acclaim, we exist. We have art, we have history, we have culture, we have ideas. This constant need for self-affirmation is exhausting and can be limiting, but we can see it as a trend for the past 100 years and more. Moderma's chapbook pays homage in its opening manifesto, The Causerie, to Geddes' Evergreen. Our earlier struggle for cultural revival is praised not only for its Scottish nationalism, but also for its civic and international character. They write, the organ of a band of social reformers in one of the poorest quarters of Edinburgh, McDermott wrote, touched an international note and kept up the spirit of the best ideals in literature and art. There is, however, a conspicuous omission. The tribute fails to mention William Sharp, who is not only a leading Evergreen contributor under his own name and as Fiona MacLeod, his pseudonym, but who also acted as managing director of the Evergreen and the affiliated publishing house of Patrick Geddes and colleagues. McDermott portrayed Geddes, who was still living and very active in 1922, as a worthy predecessor. Years later, in The Company I Kept in 1966, McDermott mourned the neglect of Geddes in Scotland, describing him as one of the outstanding thinkers of his generation, not merely in Britain, but in the world, and not only one of the greatest Scotsmen of the past century, but of our entire history. Ultimately, however, McDermott judged it necessary to dismiss the earlier Scottish Renaissance in order to move forward with a new Renaissance. The chapbook manifesto ends, the Scottish literary revival proved to be a promise that could not be kept. This reenacted demise cleared the stage for the Renaissance of 1922, Macdiarmid's Renaissance. Today, he declared, there is a distinct change in the air. Identity emerges as a central theme in Evergreen and the manifestos it contains. Various competing identities are at play. So we have this trend over the last 100 years of constant revival, constant renaissance, but also a need to negate the previous ones and to state that this is a new and fantastic thing. When Geddes and the Edinburgh Social Union encouraged artists such as Phoebe Traquair and Charles Mackie to decorate public buildings such as schools, university residences and hospitals with murals, such as the Sick Kids in Edinburgh, they did so with both civic and national pride. The Geddesian cultural insurgency was to envelop others, such as Paul Serruzier, John Duncan, William Byrne Murdoch, Mary Hill Burton, Robert Broch, Guy Hornell, and others. Seen from the perspective of today, the cultural insurgence evokes the potentiality and purpose to which Mumford referred. Man, for him, Geddes, was not just an adaptive organism, but increasingly the shaper and moulder of his own world. And in this we see the connection between cultural revival and self-determination. As Murdo MacDonald stated in the RTPI lecture in 2009, there was a moving force behind the Celtic revival in Scotland. In due course, he made common cause with the architect Charles Rennie Mackintosh on the one hand, and the great Gaelic scholar Alexander Carmichael on the other. For example, Carmichael published in Geddes' magazine The Evergreen, and his piece was introduced by a Celtic revival initial by Helen Hay. And in The Evergreen, Geddes advocated not just a Celtic revival, but a Scottish Renaissance, an idea that the poet Hugh MacDiarmid adopted to great effect. And there is in this a fabulous counterfactual what if, because in 1948, Hugh MacDiarmid applied for the post of general editor of the manuscripts of Patrick Geddes, essentially to take over the Outlook Tower. And what an extraordinary moment that would have been. He was unsuccessful. So I want to conclude just by thinking forward and thinking about this idea of the fifth estate and what it means, and what it means from the kind of trajectory that Geddes' work has left us with. Because although we've gone from the obscurity that I talked about in 1995, there was a biography written of Geddes in each decade of the 20th century, and he hasn't just blossomed out of nowhere. There's been a kind of undercurrent of influence from Geddes. And it's my argument that the trajectory of Geddes' work can now be seen in the explosion of activity in the Fifth Estate. The Fifth Estate is this idea, for those of you who are not familiar with it, that it's not an extension of the medium of the media, but networked individuals, enabled by the internet in many ways, that can hold other estates accountable. So the notion is really that the Fourth Estate, the media, the press, has failed. It has failed as a tool, as a mechanism to hold the other estates to counsel. And it's not the idea that you replace the Fourth Estate by the Fifth Estate, but that everyone is empowered to write content, to create analysis, to be an active citizen, and to take control of their own media. So it's a quite radically different notion, rather than just to say there's a problem with the old media format, and what we need to do is change it with one that's better. It's not really like that. It's actually a radical decentralization of content creation and analysis. If the ideas of participation, internationalism, visual thinking, and generalism have resonance today, they have resonance in the citizen journalist movement that is flourishing everywhere in Scotland. If ecological crisis demanded biocentrism in Geddes' day, it demands it threefold today, as we face the sort of ecological crisis that is a species challenge rather than a generational challenge. If centralization and statism and top-down managerialism demanded regionalism in Geddes' day, it demands it threefold today. If Anglo-British cultural hegemony demanded Scots Renaissance in Geddes' day, it demands its threefold today. If the search for the rounded self seemed urgent in Geddes' day, it is surely more so even today. I think the challenge we face is whether to be loyal British subjects or active Scottish citizens. And I think that that is a challenge that's laid down by Geddes 100 years ago and is evident in our contemporary culture and politics. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope you have a good discussion.